When, as we were meeting this morning, I told him, I said, yes, I said, we have more of a Methodist reign, Baptist reign. And they looked at me a little quizzically, and I was like, you know the difference, don't you? Baptist reign, you get soaking wet. A Methodist reign, you merely get sprinkled. And now don't be cruel to me. I have lots of Methodist friends that I really like. So, you know, I just told them though, I said, well, you know, nevertheless, we're here. And that's what's important. And you are here. And that's what's important. We gather each and every week, obviously, for the purpose of expressing our worship to a God who is indeed holy. He is also a God who is good and a God who is great. He is a God who loves us, a God who extends to us his grace, and a God who shows us his compassion. And as we begin our service today, it is my hope and my prayer that we will offer to God our very best in worship. It is also my hope and my prayer that we will open our hearts and our minds and our spirits to listen for the still small voice of this great God and allow him to speak to each of us at the very point of need that we have in our lives. I want us to open with a word of prayer, and then we will continue in a service of worship this morning. Would you join with me as we pray? Father God, indeed, it is a tremendous opportunity for us to gather together, either in person or via Zoom, to spend some time in worship, to praise your name, to see you as a God who is indeed great and good. But Father, even as we gather together this morning, we are mindful of those who are a part of this community of faith who are hurting. Father, we are aware of those that physically are in need of our prayers and your help. And Father, we would simply ask that you would make your presence known to them in a way that would assure them of your love and of your care. Father, there are others who are a part of this community of faith that perhaps are not struggling physically, but they are struggling emotionally or relationally. Perhaps financially and even spiritually. And Father, my prayer would be that for those of us who have gathered together this morning, that we would allow your Spirit to speak to each and every one of us at whatever point of need we have in our life. That we would allow ourselves to hear you as you seek to address us, as you seek to assist us, as you seek to encourage us, and to offer to us the hope that is found in your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, for countless individuals that we do not know and are unaware of, who themselves are finding their own lives devastated due to floods or fires or pandemic, Father, we lift them up to you, knowing that you are fully aware of their circumstance and each and every individual and what they might need. And we simply pray that you would bring into their lives those that can encourage them, those that can offer to them words of hope, words of life. Father, we just ask that you would bless our time together this morning. We ask that you forgive us the countless ways that we fail you. We just pray that when we leave this place, we will have been encouraged, but that we also will have been challenged to become better followers of your Son, Jesus Christ. And it's in his name that we offer this prayer as our Lord, our Savior, and our friend. Amen. Karen.
Our next song is Majesty.
Majesty.
grace greater than our sin.
Your So when the whole world turns against me, and I'm all by myself, and I can't hear you answer my cries for help, I'll remember the suffering your love put you through, and I will go through the valley if you want me to.
Nicely done.
Is this off now? Hopefully. Nicely done, Donna. I appreciated the message of that song as much as the arrangement. And I was glad to hear the words, because all I had seen was special music. Do you want me to? So I'm glad you did, is all I can say. You have your Bibles or New Testaments with you this morning. I invite you to turn to Mark's Gospel, Mark chapter 6. The passage that we are going to look at this morning is broken up into two parts. You will recognize that Jesus has sent out the disciples, sent out the 12. They've come back. And I want us to pick up our text this morning in verse 30 of chapter 6, where Mark tells us that the apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all they had done and taught. And because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. Following this, we have the feeding of the 5,000. And we have Jesus at the conclusion of that to tell his disciples to get into a boat and go to the other side. We find that this is the passage in verse 45 where Jesus walks on the water. But what I want us to continue is in verse 53, where again Mark tells us that when they had crossed over, they landed at Gennesaret and anchored there. And as soon as they got out of the boat, people recognized Jesus. And they ran throughout that whole region and carried the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, into villages, towns, or countryside, they placed the sick in the marketplaces. They begged him to let them touch even the edge of his cloak. And all who touched it were healed. In our text for today, apparently Jesus is trying to find some me time for him and his disciples, a time in which they can simply go off by themselves and get some rest from their just finished mission trip. Unfortunately, what he discovers is that he can't pull it off, because the crowds are clamoring for his attention. They're clamoring for his healing powers. And as our text tells us, he went from village to village,
city to city, farm to farm, and healed people. Even those who were able to reach out and touch the hem of his garments as he happened to walk by them. Now, I can't begin to tell you how many times I've read this passage. But this past week, as I read it and was reflecting on it, I couldn't help but think of this question. Why did Jesus bother to do it? I mean, let's think about it. Why would Jesus heal the sick or raise the dead only for them to get sick again or die a second time? Why would Jesus feed the crowds when just several hours later their stomach is going to be telling them, you know what, we're hungry again? Why would Jesus spend so much time and energy doing these things when ultimately they would make little to no real difference, at least not eternal significance? I mean, listen, just because Jesus had the ability to do them doesn't mean he had to do them. So why would he bother? Well, I suppose if Jesus hadn't done these things, he might never have gotten our attention otherwise. I mean, if he hadn't done these sorts of things, he probably would have just been another subversive who was crucified on a Roman cross like so many before him and after him. And we understand that that happened all the time back in that rough and tumble world of political and religious oppression. And yet it's true that some of the healing stories are the most compelling stories in all of the Gospels, especially the ones where we are told that Jesus brought the dead back to life. I got to be honest with you, it's hard for me to read the story of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead and not envisioning what he's doing. I can't hardly envision that story without getting chill bumps, goosebumps. I mean, every time I hear Jesus cry out, "Lazarus, come forth," I can almost hear those who were present suddenly gasping. I mean, there could have even been one or two of them that fainted. I mean, just think about it. Lazarus has been dead 4 days. The stinking, rotting flesh is falling off his bones. And Jesus says, "Lazarus, come forth." And Lazarus walks out of the tomb as though he just woke up from a nap. But still, I don't think Jesus' motive for doing this was simply to excite people like me and you. I mean, goosebumps are short-lived, not to mention overrated. And simple emotion doesn't sustain us. Nor do I think Jesus did these types of miracles simply to prove his power, to simply prove his ability to do them. There had to be another purpose in mind. I mean, why would he give so much of his time and spiritual energy to something he knows is not going to last? And besides that, when you do something like what he was doing often enough, well, people simply come to expect it. Which begs another question: were they even grateful for what he did? You know? I mean, how are you thinking about all this in your own mind? When those people that he healed were healed and went on with their lives, the question becomes, were they in Jerusalem to protest his arrest and his trial, his beating and his crucifixion? Perhaps some of them were there, but not all of them. No, they're simply enjoying the fruit of his compassion. I mean, you do remember the story of the healing of the 10 lepers, do you not? Jesus heals these 10 lepers, and only one returns to thank him for the fact that he's shown compassion on him. Only one. And lo and behold, that happened to be a Samaritan. Only one. In fact, Jesus wonders where the other nine have gone, even though he had sent them to the local priest to be declared healed of this disease. 10 lepers were healed, and only one returns to express his gratitude. Kind of makes you wonder how many other people Jesus healed who didn't bother to thank him for his compassion, for his effort. Listen, Jesus knew that he had a bigger, more eternal purpose in his ministry. And while we can't be certain as to when he first became aware of the cross that would inevitably take him, surely he knew that going against an entrenched religious and political system was eventually going to get him in trouble, and indeed it did. And it's obvious from what he tells his disciples that he has the kingdom in mind. That he has the kingdom in mind when he says what he says and does what he does. You see, Jesus had an eternal perspective that no one else has had since. In fact, it was the kingdom of God that was at the heart of all his teaching. I mean, we know that he instructed his followers as to how they were to live here on earth, but doing so was simply to be a reflection of how things are in God's kingdom. I mean, following Jesus is our attempt to fulfill what he said in the Lord's Prayer. You know, that part about God's will being done here on earth, even as it is in heaven. Folks, that's what his teaching's all about. Nothing Jesus ever said had anything short of eternal consequences in mind. Yet everywhere he went, in addition to his healing ministry, he wove his stories about the kingdom of heaven. Makes me wonder why Jesus didn't simply spend all of his time sharing parables and telling his stories. I mean, why even bother with a healing ministry if he knows that all of those he's caring for are eventually going to die? In other words, why give the ability to walk to a crippled person when that person's simply one day going to go to their own grave? Why cure the leper? Why give sight to the blind? Why give hearing to the deaf? Why give sanity to those who, in their way of looking at it, were demon-possessed? Why do any of those things or all of those things if he knew it wasn't going to last? In other words, why would Jesus spend his time and his energy doing those things when he knows that they're temporary? You ever wondered about these sorts of things? I'm not sure I really had ever thought about it to this point, but I think about it now. I mean, you and I are aware that Jesus did these things. The question is, why have we simply taken them for granted? Why have we simply believed all that he did as a matter of course without ever asking ourselves, why would he do such a thing? Especially when we know that exhibiting the kind of compassion that Jesus exhibited can be and is such hard work. Because you see, compassion is indeed hard work. Why do volunteers work at soup kitchens? Why do volunteers work at food and clothing pantries? Why do they work at homeless shelters when they know that the majority of those who come for help are people who are stuck in patterns of decision making that more than likely is going to constantly keep them coming back for more. Listen, we see that. Stephen and I will be called by individuals who are needing help. And they will come to the church, and we will sit with them in our office, and we will talk to them, and we will listen to their story. And we will do our very best to be compassionate and to do what we can to help them out. Only to get a call 8 to 9 months later from the very same person with the very same needs. And why do people do benevolent work for those who are down and out when they are fully aware that the same kind of bad decisions that got them into their predicament in the first place are decisions that more than likely are going to be made again when it comes to some other issue in their lives? I mean, if we're just going to be totally honest, just among us friends, both here in person and via Zoom, if we're going to be totally honest, there is a reason some people are the least of these. And the little that we do for them is not likely to change their circumstances to the point that they will ever be anything different. I mean, after all, it was Jesus who said, "The poor you will always have with you." So why bother being compassionate to those toward whom we direct our compassion is simply always going to be at our doorstep, making that phone call. Granted, they may not be exactly the same people, but they're going to be the same kind of people. Those who are asking for help, those who sometimes are expecting our help and occasionally going so far as to demand our help. And frankly, rarely, if ever, being grateful for what we do. Folks, it's really nothing new. It happens all the time. And it has happened from the very beginning of time. It's happened ever since Jesus encountered the people that he encountered. Now, many of the needs that Jesus met, we understand, were no doubt quite legitimate because it was a very tough world in which he lived. And yet, many of them may very well have come to him because he was, quite, to be honest, simply handing out his grace like it was free candy. Well, if we're able to see through people in situations like this, imagine how much more Jesus could see through the situations that he encountered. And yet Jesus spent day after day, hour after hour, going into the marketplaces and villages, responding to the needs he encountered. But we're still left with the question, why? Why? Perhaps, just perhaps, there is an answer to that question. Give me a few moments to try and explain. You see, in reflecting upon the question of why, I have reached the conclusion that Jesus did all of these things as an example of what he wanted his followers to do for all the generations to come. That includes you and that includes me. See, there is a story in Acts chapter 9, verses 36 through 43, a story about a woman named Dorcas. How many of you in here have ever heard of Dorcas? Yeah, I see some hands going up. That's good. Dorcas was the kind of person who had so much to give. But she was also a person who had so much yet to experience. And she made tunics for people who could not do it for themselves. Dorcas was the kind of person that knitted afghans for people. She made cookies. She no doubt would hold the hand of those who were sick, perhaps even going so far as to visit those people who were homebound. Indeed, we are told in Acts that she listened to the heartbreaks and joys, the toils and the triumphs of the people in the church in Joppa. Dorcas sounds pretty close, like she could be nominated for sainthood. And then one day, Dorcas died. Of all people, why Dorcas? Why Dorcas? And amidst those types of questions, the usual questions that are asked when we lose a person who's important or a person that we love, and even in the midst of all of that, her friends and her family washed her body, prepared it for burial, and laid her in a room upstairs at the house. Well, it seems as though two of her friends heard that Simon Peter was in the area, and so they made the decision to go and get him. And when they found him, they asked him, "Could you come and help us now without delay?" And Simon Peter agrees, and when they arrived, her widow friends showed Peter the tunics that Dorcas had made for them and the other clothing that she had knitted. And I'm sure they told him story after story after story that went with all the things that she had made. You can almost hear someone in that room saying, "You know what, and she knitted this for my firstborn." Well, no one says, "You know what? She knitted this afghan for my ailing mother." That sort of thing. You know how it goes. But after listening for a few moments, Peter sends them away. And Acts tells us that he knelt down beside Dorcas's body and he began to pray. And he prayed. And he prayed. Finally, he said, "Tabitha," which was her Hebrew name, "Tabitha, get up." And she did. Here's my question. How did Simon Peter have the faith and the courage to even attempt such a thing? The only answer I can come up with is just think of all the times he'd seen Jesus do it. I mean, no doubt flashing through Peter's mind and his heart were the instances in which Jesus had showed compassion for the unfortunate people he had met. And in keeping with such a ministry of hope and healing, Simon Peter, right then and there, in that particular moment of opportunity, simply decided to pay forward the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of the risen Christ. And if you reflect upon the story, you have to look at it this way. Had Jesus not conducted his ministry as he did, Simon Peter would not have raised Dorcas from the dead. And had Simon Peter not raised Dorcas from the dead, she would not have become a symbol of resurrection life in that community where she lived. And had Dorcas not become such a symbol, then guess what? Her story would not have ever been recorded in the book of Acts, and you and I would neither know of the story nor of Dorcas herself. I mean, you see how this is going, don't you? from generation to generation to generation, every act of mercy, every act of benevolence, every act of compassion is built upon that which preceded it. Which means that you and I, as Jesus followers, when you and I are willing to help someone else in his name, when you and I are willing to do that, the kingdom of God continues its influence in this world that Christ came to redeem. John Walton, in an article that appeared in the Christian Century, says the following, that, quote, compassion means to suffer with, to put yourself in the place of another, to enter into their experience. It is the primary characteristic of incarnation. It is what God was doing in Christ when God reconciled the world to God's self. It is much more than kindness. Far more radical than simply being nice. It is fulfilling the requirements of a godly life described by Micah, doing justice, loving mercy, walk humbly with your God, and doing all of it in a way that is almost imperceptible except for the compassion of it. He continues by saying, it is to take to oneself the sufferings of another so deeply that you empty yourself and take the form of a servant in the manner of Jesus, who did precisely that, even unto death, end quote. Listen, what I'm trying to say this morning is that needed more in our world than simple kindness and politeness, being nice. The thing that's needed more in our world today than perhaps in a long, long time is compassion. Compassion. But I'm going to tell you this. To show compassion is hard work. To show compassion drain you not only physically, but it can drain you emotionally, it can drain you mentally, and it might even cost you something in the way of resources. And you say, Terry, why would I do that? When, as you said earlier, 8 months later, 6 months later, they're right back needing the same thing. Why should I do it? I'll tell you why. Because it's exactly what Jesus did. It's exactly what Jesus did. Compassion is hard work. And I never, ever would stand before you and tell you otherwise. In fact, I'll be so honest as to say that when it comes to ministry, compassion is the hardest thing we do. And you ask, well, is it worth it? I can only respond to that question by simply saying, don't ask me, ask Jesus. Ask the one you claim to follow if it's worth it. However, my guess is that most of us, well, we'll never really get around to asking Jesus that question. The reason we won't ask it is if for no other reason than we already know his answer. We already know what Jesus would say in answering the question, is being compassionate worth it? Listen, we are surrounded by people who are hurting. People who are hurting, many legitimately, and others perhaps not quite as legitimate. But I've not been given the task of determining those who need compassion and those who don't. I've simply been called to follow Jesus. Show compassion. Father God, we come to you this morning. And we are grateful for the compassion shown to us by Jesus. Father, we're grateful for his life and his teachings. We're grateful for the compassion that he showed toward those who deserved it and perhaps even those who didn't deserve it according to our standard. But Father, my prayer this morning is that we might seek your forgiveness. That we might seek your forgiveness for the times that we have seen the hurts and we've heard the cries of help. And we've simply ignored them. Rather than finding the courage and the strength to reach out, to show compassion to those we encounter. Father, do we need kindness? Yes. Do we need politeness? Yes. Do we need mercy? Yes. Do we need grace? Yes. But Father, we also need compassion. We also need a willingness to reach out as Jesus did, meeting people where they are and doing the best we can do to help them. Father, there may be someone here this morning who quite honestly needs to experience your compassion. They need to experience your love and your grace by receiving your Son, Jesus Christ, as Lord and Savior of their life. Father, for those of us who are either here in person or listening via Zoom, most of us, we already claim to be followers of your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, may we hear this message this morning, both as a reminder and as a challenge. And may we find the encouragement and the strength necessary through your Spirit being at work in our lives. Father God, we are so very grateful for who you are and for all that you've done. Help us to understand that it is now our place to show forth the compassion first shown by your Son, Jesus Christ, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand. Karen's going to come and lead us in a song of response. It's wherever he leads, I'll go. And I invite you to reflect upon the words of the song, to reflect upon the words of this message, and to reflect upon where you are in your relationship with the living God. Let's stand and sing together.
Take up my cross and follow me. I am my master's slave. I gave my life to ransom thee. Surrender your all today.
Once again, I want to express my appreciation for your coming and sharing with us this morning in worship, either in person or via Zoom. I simply am going to pray that we go from this place, and as we encounter various individuals, that we make it a point of showing them compassion, showing them kindness, showing them grace. I hope each and every one of you have a great week. I hope you stay safe. And having said that, let us go forth from this place in the grace and peace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You are dismissed. God bless you.